Well, students, in this lecture, we are going to start with the chapter of X-rays. Well, first of all, what are X-rays? So, X-rays are electromagnetic waves which have a very high energy or a very short wavelength. Okay, so if you see the electromagnetic spectrum starts with radio waves, lowest in energy are radio waves, then microwaves, then infrared, then visible light, the light which we can see, then comes ultraviolet, then comes X-rays, and highest in energy are gamma rays. So X-rays are in the higher energy region of the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, so they have a higher energy, much more higher energy compared to visible light. Okay, in terms of wavelength, X-rays have a very short wavelength compared to microwaves or radio waves. They have a very short wavelength. The wavelength of X-rays is something around 10 raised to minus 10 meters, which is what we call as Armstrong unit, 1 Armstrong unit. So the wavelength of X-rays is around 1 Armstrong unit. Okay. So what are X-rays are? X-rays are electromagnetic waves having a much higher energy compared to visible light and having a very short wavelength around 1 Armstrong unit. Now, how are X-rays produced? So the basic principle behind production of X-rays is that X-rays are produced when fast moving electrons, high speed electrons, strike a suitable target. Okay, so let me explain this to you. So these are fast moving electrons, high speed electrons. How these high speed electrons produced? The electrons are produced by actually a heated filament, tungsten filament. When you heat up the filament by passing current through it, the electrons are produced. And how they become very fast? How is the speed of the electrons increased? The speed of the electrons is increased by applying a very high voltage, positive voltage. Because of the high voltage, the electrons are pulled, accelerated, and they gain very high speed. So remember, these fast moving electrons are produced by a heated tungsten filament and they acquire high speed by applying a very high voltage, which is called as an accelerating voltage. We'll be talking about this later on. Okay, so these fast moving electrons are made to strike a suitable target, like let us say copper, tungsten, molybdenum. It's a metal target, high atomic number target. So when fast moving electrons strike this target, what happens to them? They are quickly brought to rest. So they were moving very fast, and now when they strike the target, they are quickly brought to rest. Their velocity becomes zero. So what happens therefore is that when the electrons were moving very fast, they had a very high kinetic energy, because kinetic energy is half mv square. So when the velocity is high, kinetic energy is high. When they strike the target, they are brought to rest. Velocity becomes zero. So the kinetic energy becomes zero. So the electrons had a very high kinetic energy when they were moving. When they strike the target, the kinetic energy becomes zero. So where does the energy go then? The kinetic energy is converted partly into heat and partly given out as X-rays. Okay, so the kinetic energy of the electrons when it strikes the target becomes zero, and that kinetic energy is converted and given out as X-rays. So this is the basic principle behind production of X-rays. When fast moving electrons hit the target, the electrons lose the kinetic energy to the target, and in the process the kinetic energy is converted partly into heat and partly into X-rays. Now, the electrons which strike the target, they lose kinetic energy, and this loss of kinetic energy can take place by two different processes, which gives rise to two different types of X-rays: characteristic X-rays and continuous X-rays. Okay, so let's see what are the two different processes and what are the two different types of X-rays. So the first process which gives rise to the first type of X-rays, characteristic X-rays, let's study that. So, as I told you, in this electrons, when they strike the target, now what is there inside this target? The target is made up of atoms. You know that all materials are made up of atoms. So in this target also there are many atoms. So when the electrons strike the target, what happens basically is the electrons strike the atoms of this target. So that is what is shown in this figure. So what is this? Is a target atom. It is one of the atoms of the target. And what is falling on this target atom is the electron, fast moving electron coming from the filament. Okay, so these are high speed electrons going and hitting the target atoms. Now, these electrons have a very high energy, very high speed. They can penetrate right deep inside the atom and knock out an electron from the innermost shell, the K shell. Okay, so okay, the atom, you know, has a nucleus in the center and electrons orbiting around the nucleus in circular orbits, fixed orbits. The orbits are given names like K, level, L level, M level, and so on, K shell, L shell, M shell, and so on. So now, this electron, since it has high energy, it can penetrate right deep inside and knock out an electron from the innermost shell. Remember, it is very difficult to knock out innermost electrons. Outer shell electrons can be easily removed with lesser energy. But to remove inner shell electrons, you require very high energy. But these electrons have that much energy. They are very high speed electrons. So they have that much high energy by which they can even knock out electrons from the innermost shell. So electron from the K shell, innermost shell, is knocked off from here, removed from here. And a vacancy is created in the K shell. Now such an atom with a vacancy down there is highly unstable. So this vacancy has to be filled up. Who fills up the vacancy? Any electron from the upper levels, the L level or the M level or the N level, can jump down into this vacant K shell and fill up the vacancy. So let us imagine an electron from the L level jumps down into the vacant K shell. Now when the electron jumps down from a higher level to the lower level, the excess energy, since it had higher energy, it now come down to a lower energy level, the excess energy difference between the two levels is given out as radiation, is given out as photons, and in this case they are X-ray photons. Okay, so this is how X-rays are produced, characteristic X-rays are produced. When electron, fast moving electron, strikes the atom and knocks out innermost electron from the vacant K shell. So this is how the electron loses energy. This fast moving electron loses kinetic energy. How? It strikes the electron in the innermost shell, transfers the energy to the electron. So the kinetic energy is transferred to the electron, and in the process the electron is removed from that shell and a vacancy is created. Okay, so the vacancy is filled up by upper electron jumping down, and in the process the energy difference between the two levels is given out as an X-ray photon. Now why this is called as characteristic X-rays? Why these X-rays which are given out, these X-rays which are given out in this process called as characteristic X-rays? They're called characteristic X-rays because the wavelength of the X-rays which is given out is dependent on the target. It doesn't depend on how fast these electrons were moving. Okay, it doesn't depend on how much voltage was applied to the electrons to accelerate them. It doesn't depend on that. It depends on only the target atom. If you change the target, then the wavelength of the X-rays given out will change. If you change the speed of the electrons, this wavelength will not change. So the wavelength of the X-rays given out does not depend on the speed or the accelerating voltage applied. It depends only on the target atom. So it is characteristic of the target material, whether it's copper or molybdenum or tungsten or what target you're using for the electrons hitting the target. Okay, so that's why it is called as characteristic X-rays. One more interesting feature of this characteristic X-rays is the discrete nature of the X-rays. Okay, the wavelengths which are given out are fixed lines, fixed wavelengths. They are not continuous. Let us explain this energy level diagram of this characteristic X-rays. So suppose the vacancy is created in the K shell. Now who can fill up the vacancy? So if the vacancy is down here in the K shell, any electron from the L or the M or the N, any upper level electron can jump down. So the first possible transition is electron from the L shell jumping down to the vacant K shell. And during this transition, the difference in energy, as I told you, is given out as an X-ray. And this X-ray is called as a K alpha X-ray or the K alpha line, K alpha X-ray line. If the vacancy down here is filled up by an electron from the M shell jumping down, the X-ray photon which is given out is called a K beta X-ray or K beta line, and similarly K gamma line, and so on. Suppose the vacancy was in the L shell, suppose this electron had hit an L shell electron over here and knocked it off, suppose the vacancy was created here, then electron from here can jump down M shell or the N shell can jump down. And such X-rays, they are called as the L alpha, L beta, L gamma X-rays, and so on. Okay, so the vacancy can be filled up from L level, that will give rise to L alpha line. If it is from N level, coming down to the L, it is called L beta line, and so on. So all these transitions are ending on the L level. So they are called as L series or the Balmer series. Here, all the transitions are ending onto the vacant K level. So they are called as K series lines, K alpha, K beta, K gamma, or they are called as the Lindemann series. Now out of all these lines, this K alpha line is very important for us because it is the most prominent line. Out of all these lines, X-ray lines which you see, this is the most prominent line. Yeah, K beta is also there, but it is less intense. But K alpha line is always the most intense line. So therefore, it is also the most important line. So this is the energy level diagram or the different X-ray series, Lindemann series means the K series, or the Balmer series also called as the L series, and so on. Okay, so please remember this diagram. It will be important later on while calculating the wavelength of the different X-rays, K alpha line. Remember especially these quantum numbers, K level corresponds to the quantum number n equal to 1, L corresponds to n equal to 2, n equal to 3. I think you know about this. Okay, so these are the different energy levels and their corresponding quantum numbers. Okay, so now these are characteristic X-rays, and as I had told you, the wavelength of the X-rays emitted is characteristic of the target element and is independent of the voltage which is applied here, independent of the speed of the electrons. So it's dependent only on the target X-ray, so target atom. So that's why they are called as characteristic X-rays, because the wavelength is characteristic of the target atom. So that's about characteristic X-rays. The other one, continuous X-rays, we'll be talking about in the next lecture. Thank you.